into the class now.
Yeah.
Okay. So what we'll do is, so you have a product backlog, and a particular subset of this product backlog will be called as a sprint backlog. Now the point is, as far as the product backlog is considered, anything, any kind of a will and wish can be put over here, but there should be a definition of a ready when you pull the stories from the product backlog to the sprint backlog. So sprint backlog is definitely a subset of the product backlog, and this backlog will be continuously prioritized. Okay, so as far as agile is considered, we will generally tend to always work on the highest priority item. So once I actually pull it to the sprint backlog, depending upon the goal of the sprint, I will be committing to some of the user stories based on the velocity of the team or based on the capacity planning, and we commit to the goal of the sprint, and you do a 2-week sprint or a 3-week sprint, and at the end of the sprint, you are actually trying to ship a potentially shippable increment, because there is no guarantee at the end of every sprint the code will go to the production. And then probably outside the sprint window, you may still have your performance testing or a UAT, or you need to define the scope of the sprint, right? What test I'm going to include it within the sprint container. Outside, you need to anyway carry on with the release planning activities, and then you will be going to the, and then you will be deploying it. Now, any questions here on the basic flow? No, Magesh?
No, Balaji, that's fine.
Okay, now what we will do is that now this is the basic flow. Now actually let us get into one by one slowly. Okay, now as far as the role is concerned, I'm just going to use some internet just for a reference purpose. Okay, all right, so 1 minute. So what we will do is that Scrum Sprint, and then I will just directly take from the images. Okay, just for our comfortable. Now let me ask one question here. On what basis you will be defining the length of this sprint? What thoughts come to your mind? Because in this example we used 2 weeks. Some team used to have 3 weeks. No, so on what basis you will generally decide the length of this sprint? Any thoughts?
No, I don't know exact reason why it is chosen 2 weeks or 4 weeks. And most of the sprint that I have worked on, the organization already had a framework saying that it's a 2-week sprint. But I really have no idea on what basis these weeks have been picked up.
Okay, so generally you may need to understand something called as a demand and a supply mapping, right? Demand and the supply mapping means what is the input demand from the upstream system, at what rate the downstream system is going to consume your processed work, and you may need to balance the input and the output demand. And also, which is actually one thing, the second reason is you may need to look into your sprint backlog container. In this sprint backlog, what are the different work item types? For example, if I have a change request, or if I have a maintenance or an incident support ticket, generally those things will come with a fixed date. So when there is a time constraint on the work item type, which is inside the container of the sprint backlog, general tendency is to have a shorter sprint. You are getting that point, what I'm trying to tell?
Yeah.
See, first of all, we need to understand in the sprint backlog what it is inside, how many green balls, how many yellow balls, how many blue color balls. Green balls are called as defects. I'm just giving an example, okay? Green ball, let's say green balls are called as defects. Blue color balls are called as maintenance tickets. And green and yellow color balls are called as support or incident tickets. Now, when there is a heterogeneous backlog, generally speaking, and it has a tightly aligned to some dates, generally the tendency of the organization is to have a shorter sprint, so that you can quickly create a feedback loop, and whatever the item which is tagged to SLA, it can be shipped to the production.
Okay.
Okay, this is one thing. So first of all, fundamental thing is what is the input, what is the upstream flow rate, what is the downstream consumption. See, from where the input comes, from where the requirement is getting triggered to you, it is called the upstream for you. And who is going to consume your work? That is called the downstream. Hey, one second, yeah, this guy Dana is calling. I will now tell him to.
Okay.
Hey, Magesh, we can continue. So I just told him if it is possible to join, or else we will send the recording to him. Okay.
Okay.
Fine. So what I'm trying to tell is the point is simple. Look into the input flow rate. How many input things are coming inside the board for you? When I say board, I'm talking about your task board. Okay. Whatever be the tool used, you use Jira or Rally or version 1, it is a sprint task board. And look into the output flow rate. So generally what will happen, actually speaking, if someone asks me, do not start it with a shorter sprint. It is always a danger.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, start it with a 3 weeks sprint at least. Once you get stabilized, once you get matured, then you can bring it to 2 weeks.
Okay.
Now, what will happen is that if you started with it 2 weeks and if the product owner is keep on changing the requirements, let's say for example, because you actually know how the industry works. Sometimes the product owner will tell one requirement at the beginning and then he will change something else at the later. So if that is the case, the general rule of thumb is to begin with a longer sprint, and once you prove some success, then slowly you try to bring down the length of the sprint. Okay, this is basics. Now, let us get into something called a definition of a ready. Okay, when I say definition of ready, what I need to ensure so that my product, my story can be pulled from the product backlog into the sprint backlog. So, what thoughts come to your mind? What are all the pointers which need to be ready?
Say one thing is like we should be good in the refinement. Like definition of ready would only satisfy if it is properly refined. The items are properly refined, so we can say it's ready for development. So then only those items would be pulled up in our sprint backlog.
Yeah, correct. So in the chat, let me ping you some of the points for now. First thing, user story should have an acceptance criteria. Correct. Criteria means what? Definition of done is going to talk from a technical point of view. Acceptance criteria is going to talk from a functional point of view. On giving a proper user ID and password, clicking on submit button, it should take to the landing page. It should take to the home page. That functionality need to be ensured, which will be the acceptance criteria. So point number one is, before I pull the story, I need to check whether the story have an acceptance criteria. Second thing is what? Story need to be sized, right? If I don't size, the use of pulling the story and then thinking about sizing it. Second, okay, one more point. User stories need to be properly parented. Parented means what? See, the reason I'm asking these questions, so that your mind is getting attuned to the interview mode. Okay. Properly parented means, okay, what thought comes to your mind?
See, I mean, if it is, I mean, it should be properly referred to the story or an epic which is which we are
But you should not, we should not directly go to the epic. From the story, it need to properly parented to your feature. Feature,
okay.
Yeah, right? And that feature will be parented to a sub-epic or a theme. If you are using Rally as a tool, it is called a sub-epic. If you are using Jira as a tool, it is called a themes, T-H-E-M-E-S. And again, the sub-epic and themes need to be parented to a epic.
Okay.
So you need to check whether the proper parenting has been done, story is sized, whether the story has clarity on the acceptance criteria. Then what we need to check? Any other thought comes to your mind? Dependencies had been called out, right? At least on a high level. You should not see, you should not start the story and then talk about the dependencies. When the moment the product backlog refinement happens itself, we need to talk about the dependencies. I will tell you a simple format how you can capture the dependencies. Let's take an Excel file like this. You imagine, you know, this is as an Excel file. So what I used to do is, of course, if you're using Rally as a tool, it is having something called a deep export grid view. So deep export grid view option in the Rally will show feature level dependency. Now I am talking about story level dependency. So say for example, something like this, I'll just show you. Here what I'm doing on the row of here, I'm actually putting the team names. Team 1, team 2, team 3, 4 and 5. Okay, and here I'm actually putting the user story 1. User story 1 to user story 10. Okay, just for the example. Now, when you do the product backlog refinement itself, one need to have a clarity. For user story 1, it has a dependency with these two teams. For user story 2, it has a dependency with these two teams. So something like that, if you are able to create a grid view, then by the time you start the story, you can act, you can proactively engage the dependent teams. Did you understand what I'm trying to tell?
Yeah.
So put it in a simple Excel file. See, the always the tool is just an enabler. See, the tool will not give original thinking. The tool will enable your work. The thinking part the tool will not give. The maybe the tool will give some settings to enable it. All that I'm trying to tell is, generally I used to tell my scrum masters, do you have a dependency tracker? Like, can you tell me something pictorially? What are all the teams? What are all the user stories for the current sprint? And where is the dependency? If so, what is the plan to ensure these dependencies are at least talked early? Forget about fulfilling it. You need to talk early. Only when you start the communication, it will take its own course of time to get it fulfilled. Okay. So this is one thing. Second thing, you need to maintain an impediment tracker. It need to tell serial number, impediment, what is the blocker and who is actually working on it, what is the ETA, so that you as a scrum master can make a meaningful follow-ups. Okay.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to tell is, now with this understanding, now you can read more on a definition of a ready. See, I'm now starting from basics. Okay. Don't think that all classes will be like basics, because this is the first class. Now we are starting slowly. We will actually shift the gear one by one.
Okay.
Because it's the first class, I'm just taking from basics. From the second one, third, fourth class, you'll get into Kanban, Kanban metrics. Then they'll directly go into agile transformation. So with this understanding, what needs to be done? So actually what needs to be done will actually vary from context to context. Okay. So, and actually one more important point here, before I pull the user story, had I decomposed into some tasks and at least on a high level subtask, right? So do all these things, make sure that the definition of ready is met. And actually speaking, before you pull the story, you need to have definition of done also written, either at a story level or at a sprint level. Okay, I'm not going to debate upon which level you want to make it, because practically I have seen some stories, you cannot generalize the DOD. So you need to have some definition of done clarity, acceptance criteria, story need to be parented, story should have, should be sized and need to be assigned to a team member, and the task and the subtask needs to be created. High level dependency clarity should be done. Then you pull the story into the sprint backlog and then start working on it, right? Which we generally do.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then in our daily stand-up call, we will discuss what is the flow and all those things. And then you tend to give a demo and then you will do a retrospective. Now the problem is, if the update in the Jira is not working out, then your burn down graph, you know about burn down graph, right? So I'm not going to draw once again. And now instead of this, if your burn down comes like this also, it is okay. At least if your burn down comes also like this, okay. But most of the companies burn down will be like this and then here.
Yeah.
One of the reason will be testing had been started only on the 7th day or the 8th day.
Correct. Yeah.
One more reason is that properly the team had not put a task and a subtask at completion as and when they complete the work. So you may need to bring some, you may need to start with bringing some practice saying that half an hour before the daily stand-up meeting or call, Jira update need to be completed as a team. So that when you are projecting your Jira dashboard, the real status is being projected because someone would have completed, but it is not been reflecting in the tool. So that kind of discipline need to be brought in. And one more question you can ask in the stand-up call. Are there anyone working on any other action items like stories or tasks which is not being captured in the Jira? Then someone will tell, yes, I'm working on the compliance activity, but it is not captured in the Jira. So immediately make a capture in the Jira. So start with the simple things like this, one by one. Then, and once today's class is completed, I will send you the team charter working agreement, right? I will show you now. Just give me a minute.
Yeah.
Charter working agreement is an important thing when you are beginning the journey. Okay, I'll just show you later. Let it come. I'm just yet to put all these things in some folders. I'll just take it from the guys when they send them. See, if you see like this, open and done. Let it come. See, this particular team charter is a work. Okay, let me put it in the slideshow. Okay, so that you can see it. I will anyway send this. So we are now starting with the basics here. Team name, what is the mission statement of our team? What are the ground rules? See, before and all, we used to have a ground rule. If you want to take work from home, then you can take only on a Wednesday. Okay, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
Because every one guy will go on in one day means it will be difficult for me. So some kind of a minimal ground rule. Okay. Surprisingly, strange thing. This escape is not working. This is not working. Can I do one thing? Can I just send it through WhatsApp? No. Can you open it there? No, parallelly.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. One second. Wait. I'm just sending it through WhatsApp. You quickly open it there instead of waiting for this. This. He is coming now. One minute. I just sent it. You might have got. Okay. Anyway, it is also working here. Okay. So I'm putting some. See, for example, what will be the core working hours? What is the vacation planning? Update Jira daily to ensure all work items to reflect the current state. And the responsibilities. And this is a user story slicing. Hope you heard of it, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, can you? Okay, Can you just tell me on a high level what you know about this?
I mean, these items, right? Like independent, correct, negotiable, valuable, estimable. Mm. Yeah. Mm. I mean, see, the first point says about there should be no dependency. So it should be clear cut without any dependency. Negotiable is like telling about what is to be done and what is.
So you
like
have
it's like
so, yeah,
good
yeah,
to have.
Second.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. One second. Sorry to cut you. One thing here is the three C's: card, conversation, and the confirmation.
Okay,
it is called the three C's. Okay, so you show the card, no, during the planning poker technique. So it is called card. The story itself is a evolving one. See, as far as traditional waterfall model, requirements are static documents. But as far as agile user story is considered, stories evolve out of a conversation. You will tell something, that guy will tell something, then the product owner will tell something else.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the scope is kept flexible. Okay. Then it should yield some value.
Okay.
Then it should be sizable. No, estimatable means it should be sizable. That is why in the definition of a ready itself, we are putting the story points also. Okay, and then you need to slice it so vertically so that it can fit within a sprint, because I cannot take one sprint and then keep it beyond two or three sprint. I cannot take one story which is beyond a sprint also, right? Okay, and followed by testable. All right. So this is one thing we have, but apart from this, I'll just show. Dana, you had joined, huh? Okay, Dana. One more technique is a deep technique, okay, which I'm just pinging in the chat. Detailed, emergent, estimatable, and prioritized. So the story should have been detailed out with some description and all the details. Emergent means the story, the nature of the story itself will be a evolving one, which we call it as a conversation. The story should be sizable and the story should have been prioritized. What prioritization technique you use, we will see later when we come to prioritization. At a feature level, if you have already done the WSJF prioritization, which is called weighted shortest job first, then automatically the story will try to inherit that particular priority from the feature. People inherit the property from the parents, right? Similarly, the level of prioritization a story takes to a considerable extent comes from the priority of the feature. And feature priority comes from the epic and the sub-epic. Okay. Dana? Or he is not able to come? Okay, Dana? I think he has some challenges. Okay, so what I'm trying to tell is, so once you prioritize the user story, depending upon the goal of the sprint, you actually pull it and then you actually begin the sprint. So coming back to this team charter, I'll just quickly finish it up one by one. Okay, coming back to the team charter, you have this followed by the user story definition of done. Definition of done is at a technical level. Acceptance criteria is at a functional level. Got it right, Magesh? Here, definition of done is more at a technical level. What needs to be done in terms of deployment, build, and okay, all those aspects. And then what we used to do is, sometimes when you have a heterogeneous backlog item, we also used to define some process policies here. If you have a change request, probably how to handle it. Instead of user stories, it is better to have the word work item types. If you have different work item types, how to handle it. Then here we have given some story sizing guidelines. Okay, and followed by the meetings. What is the purpose of the meeting? Frequency, duration, participants. Any questions here? Magesh?
No questions.
Okay, you are okay, right, with this? Okay, this is the basics.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will keep continuing. I cannot hear Dana, but I hope he is able to hear us. So I will continue with the flow for now. Okay, now when you come to release planning, like when you are planning for the release, important point which we need to keep in mind is, see, which I'm actually pinging in the chat now. Release length is equal to, release length is equal to number of sprints into sprint length. Right, logically, if you take the number of sprints and then if you are multiplying by the length of the sprint, you should be able to do the length of the release. But from where will you get the number of sprints for a particular team? You need to first of all size the release backlog, right? You need to size the release backlog and then divide it by the average velocity of the team. That is why we are saying it is always good to know what is the average velocity of the team, because the velocity is going to give the burn rate, how much I can burn. So simple example is like this. Let's say I, for an easy calculation purpose, if my release backlog has a 300 story points at a release level, and if the average velocity of my team per sprint is 30, I'm just giving an example, then probably I needed 10 sprints. And if one sprint is approximately 3 weeks, then approximately I will be, you know, need 30 weeks. But 1 week is actually 5 days only, because excluding the weekend. So 30 into 5, 150 man days. You are able to understand this, Magesh?
Yeah.
So what I'm seeing now, this is a theory. Now let us talk about practicality. Practically, what will happen in the industry? Company will already maintain a release calendar. It could be a major release or a minor release. So date is already fixed. The scope can be a little bit varied here and there. See, that's what happens in the industry, right? As far as your CSM, PSM certifications, all those certifications will actually tell you, you size the release backlog, you divide it by the average velocity of the team, that will give number of sprints. If one sprint is 2 weeks, then it is 20. If one sprint is 3 weeks for the team, then 10 into 3, 30, into 5 you can take approximately. But actual practical situation happened, the date is already fixed, saying this particular feature need to be deployed in the production on this date. Now you need to work backward, at least to some extent. And for an easy calculation, that is why we are saying to some extent we need to have clarity. What is my average velocity of my team? Given a work, how much story points I will be able to deliver approximately? Okay.
Okay.
Okay. This is like in terms of the agile release planning. Now, these kind of templates I will be sending you one by one. But you can also start creating, you both of you guys can start creating your own custom template. So in this, like I think you can go on mute. If you are not talking, you can go on mute. So what I'm trying to tell is, it's a major release or it's a minor release, depending upon the things. And I'm now creating something like, okay, at a level, what am I trying to deliver? If you look here, you know, some kind of a calendar, like for example, let's see, from this date, when does the backlog refinement is going to happen? When does the daily stand up, as the word indicates, it will happen daily. Whereas if you take a iteration planning, once in 10 days or once in 9 days, or depending upon the length of the sprint. So you need to have a visualization like this. If you are taking May month, see, for example, your client manager or your manager may tell you, okay, furnish me the sprint calendar. When you ask for a sprint calendar, what that person wants is, in terms of the ceremonies of the sprint, they are expecting a clarity. When is the product backlog? When is the sprint planning? When is the sprint demo? When is the sprint retrospective? Something like this, you should be able to create. All right.
Yeah.
Okay, one more thing. This is to start with. To start with, you can use an Excel file. What we used to do at an industry level is, if you are using Jira as the tool, predominantly Confluence will be used for a documentation and the artifact management repository. So in the Confluence, we used to create something called a team space, project space, and the product space. Inside the project space, I will be maintaining release calendar. in and together with the release calendar, I will be having this Excel sheet of a release planning. You can even still create it in the Confluence and then share that link to all. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, this is one thing. I will show you something else wherein I started putting new variable names. 1 minute, I'll just see. Okay, one more template. See, in the internet you have the templates here. I can also send you, but I wanted you guys to develop the ability of creating your own custom templates. See, look into the parameters first. What is the goal of the release? When someone is saying that yes, we do have a release, first thing you need to ask, hey, what is the goal of the release? Like we have sprint goal, what is the goal of the release? What are we trying to do? Second thing, is it a major release or a minor release? And what is the connotation for major, minor? That connotation is purely driven by the ecosystem. Based on your product landscape or project landscape, you need to define what do you mean by major or what do you mean by minor. Then what is the prerequisite? Then the scope of the release, like I am going to move this particular feature only for country channels like Hong Kong, Singapore, Malaysia, number 2, something else, number 3, something else. Because sometimes what will happen, no, practically release go, the scope of the release is not simple thing like what we do in certification. It's not like I need to deploy this feature, something from feature X, something from feature Y, something from sub epic Z. Everything will need to be conglomerated or amalgamated into a goal of a release. Then you have countries say impacted. See, here I have called the impact of this particular release is at a line of business level or at a product line level or at a product group level. Then the release date, then what are all the approvals needed? Because if you are working in a BFSI domain or a healthcare domain where there is high governance and regulatory mechanism, without approvals you cannot push the code to the production. So you need to start these approvals at least 14 days before. Then for this release, how many program increments happen, how many sprints happen, some clarity on the upstream and the downstream, and the release workflow, the entire flow. After you push the code, after demo, where it goes, maybe a performance testing sign off, then a UAT sign off, then maybe you have a window for a production deployment. Okay, now any questions here, you can ask me. If Dana has any questions, he can actually ping in the chat.
Yeah, Balaji, we follow one more thing, release cards. So is that part of this?
What is that? Release card.
Okay, what that card will tell? Okay, this would something say about when we're going to release this feature and what are the necessary approvals or necessary environments where the feature has to be.
Correct.
Like
correct.
That we'll do. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So I think this particular release card may be a term which is specific to your company or your portfolio. In industry, I don't hear something, but I'll show you something. See, one thing, what I used to do, I will show you practically. I created this particular sheet called flow orchestration. See, all these things will be sent to you at the right time. Yeah. Just give me some time. Okay. So what used to happen is, in this particular flow orchestration, we do have, like, see here, like something called a product roadmap. I have something called a PI targeting and something called a release targeting, and I tend to promote visibility. Hey, which PI, which sub-epic, which particular feature am I going to position? Are you understanding what I'm trying to tell?
Yeah.
At this level, if you create a visibility, see, generally people struggle because they have not done enough homework. They have not cleaned the epic and the sub-epic. They have not cleaned the features. So what will happen when they come to story, instead of spending time on working on the story, they will be spending time on, instead of spending time on executing the story, they will be spending time on understanding the story. All these things should be done outside the window of the sprint.
Correct, yeah.
Okay, I will be sending you this sheet when I really touch upon scaled agile framework. I need to do some changes because all these are old dates. I will do this and then I will send it to you later. All okay, now one more thing I will tell you. Generally, people have a mindset, I am executing agile, right? So agile should take care of all my problems. It is not like that. Even in traditional waterfall model, when you are doing the release planning, you need to have clarity on all these aspects. Forget about agile for now. Even in a traditional waterfall model, I need to have clarity on what is the goal of the release. Is it a major or a minor? What are the prerequisites? What is the scope? This has nothing to do with agile. Agile comes only here. Other things and all, it's a core project management capability. So practically in the industry, it is not enough if you just do Scrum Master role by the book. You need to have some project management capability, facilitation skill, then agile knowledge. Everything need to be mixed. Does my answer sound practical, right?
Yeah, correct, yeah.
So generally people will ask me, as a Scrum Master, what am I supposed to do? The point is very simple. You need to do only two things. Set up a call with your client manager at the beginning of the journey itself and understand from your client manager, hey, what am I supposed to do exactly in this ecosystem? You know what are the roles and responsibility of a Scrum Master, but in this project, what am I supposed to do? Speak to your client manager, understand what are you supposed to do, and also understand based on what parameters or aspects your own performance will be measured. Same thing you need to do with your reporting manager from your parent organization or the vendor, because this is what, you know, I used to do. Any new project or any new organization, I will set up discussion with my reporting manager and my client manager. I will get to know what am I supposed to do, and then I will start doing it. Point is simple.
Okay.
See, even in the interview, if someone asks me, as a Scrum Master, what you did, my answer will be, see, as a Scrum Master, I have done different things in different engagements. Let me tell you a couple of examples. I will tell like that, and then I will tell my answer. Because that's a practical answer. If you tell, I will conduct daily stand-up, I will participate in all the meetings, that seems to be, okay, that's a barest minimum expected. But what you do exactly depends upon what are you supposed to do when you actually hired for the position. Okay, one more thing let me tell you. When it comes to BFSI domain, this audit will be there. Okay, so as a Scrum Master, sometimes I have taken care of the audits. You know, right? Like the compliance activities. Okay, whether all the documentation is properly maintained. When you say that you have reviewed the code, who has reviewed the code? Do you have a timestamp? What is the coding standard guidelines? Do you have a checklist? Each and everything will be reviewed. And everything will be maintained in the documents repository in the Confluence.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
Yes, those links also need to be reviewed periodically. So now what it means is, when there is a compliance activity, when you do capacity planning, when you do sprint planning for the sprint, which is called capacity planning, you need to create placeholders for all these activities. If not, what will happen? The sprint will be in the middle. Then suddenly compliance requirements will come and it will create some kind of a disturbance to the goal of the sprint. Let us give some time. He has dropped off. Dana, can you type any questions? Just ask him. I just wanted to know from Dana whether he has any questions. You have any questions, Magesh, in the meantime?
No, it's going good, yeah.
Okay. So, one more important point what I wanted to tell is, when you guys do the retrospective, no, you are capturing some of the action items, right? Those action items also, you better convert it into a user story and use it for the next sprint.
Okay.
See, why are you doing a retrospective, Magesh? Tell me from your point of view. Why are we doing a retrospective?
Yeah, only for better improvement. Like if the team feels any shortfalls are there.
So to improve my health, is it enough if I really start on that diet plan and exercise, or if I document only diet plan and exercise? I need to work on it, right?
Correct.
So identifying the improvement, identifying the improvement is only half of the picture. Someone need to work on it. And do you think that your guys will work on it if they are not given time in the sprint? No one is going to work on it, right? Let's be practical. So what I used to do is every time when I am doing a capacity planning or in this sprint planning meeting, in the sheet, I will be creating placeholders for the retrospective action items, at least 5% of the total capacity. So I used to ask my team, hey team, okay, till now how many items you have captured? Let's say they have captured 15 points. Again, I will ask them to prioritize it. Even in the improvement action item, you need to prioritize and take only top 2 or 3 for now. And you put it in the goal of the sprint, and in the goal of the sprint, you can include this particular goal also, as simple as that. So that information becomes transformation. If not, it will remain only as an information. Right?
Yeah.
Reading a holy books like Bhagavad Gita or something is completely different from following it. Following will happen later. Similarly, you have done a retrospective. Now you came to know where you need to improve, but someone need to work on it to make it done. So these things and all you may need to tell in the interview. Okay, so I used to maintain a retrospective backlog, even the retrospective action items will be prioritized continuously. And when we do the capacity planning of the sprint, we used to create placeholders and we pull the user stories appropriately and give some examples also. Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, now one more thing. I'm now slowly shifting the gear to the next layer. Now what I'm saying, like you guys do product backlog refinement, right? Product backlog refinement. So what you do there, you take the user story and then refine it. Why don't you guys do a program level meeting called a feature backlog refinement? You take the feature itself. In the Jira, if you put a filter on the feature, or if I go to Rally, because Rally treats everything as a workspace, as per the concept, everything will be workspace. You need to select your workspace and then you need to go to the portfolio Kanban board. In the portfolio Kanban board, you will be having a drop down like epic, sub-epic or a feature. If you select feature in the drop down, that particular features will be shown. Now, why don't you do a cleanup at a feature level? If you do start doing cleanup at a feature level periodically, believe me, all the benefits will flow to the user story. And if you do feature backlog refinement, then possibly you can handle, sometime back I showed you, that particular dependency management board, that small grid board. That board can be handled in a better manner. Any thoughts now?
Yeah, that is good. That is actually a good idea. Actually, most of the team don't follow this feature backlog refinement. That is what I know.
Yeah. So the teams are struggling to get clarity on the user story because there is no clarity on the feature backlog. There is no clarity on the feature backlog because there is no clarity on the epic and the sub-epic.
Correct.
So in my LinkedIn article, I have already written some articles on what are the program level cadences and portfolio level cadences. Just go to my articles and then take it and then read it.
Okay.
So if my portfolio backlog has been kept in the radar and with a good health, that benefit will flow to feature. Similarly, if my feature backlog is getting refined continuously, that benefit will flow to user story. If not, only problems will actually flow. So in my team, for my team, once in 10 days, I have a recurrence meeting. See, because in my last engagement, I was handling as a program level coach. So I was handling 15 teams, 15 squads, and every team had product owner and this scrum master. So what I used to do, I used to coach only my product owner and their scrum master. They will in turn go and coach the team. I cannot coach one by one for all the guys. So at that time, I used to tell them once in 10 days or once in 2 weeks at least, fortnightly, have a recurrence invite for feature backlog refinement. Then the product owner will come to us and then say, yeah, this feature is not having clarity because that particular sub-epic has not been funded. Only funded initiatives can be taken for work. So these are all systemic issues which you need to deal.
Correct, yeah.
So when you really deal these things practically, then you no need to prepare for the interview what challenges you have handled and how did you overcome it. Because you have already done it, no. You can present it well.
Correct, yeah.
Okay, so this is one thing. Having a good grip on the dependency management right from the feature backlog refinement at least, maintaining an impediment tracker and ensuring that there is a clarity on the goal of the sprint. Now, for the next 10 minutes, I'm just going to take one topic and then we can end the call there. We can continue next. See, my next topic is requirements governance within the sprint, which is very, very important one from an interview point of view. Meaning to say, you are in the middle of the sprint. Let's say you have 3 weeks sprint. Already 1.5 week have passed. You are in the middle of the sprint. Now your product owner comes and says, hey, can you entertain these 3 stories now? Can you add 4 more stories? Now, how will you respond to it?
Yeah.
You share your thoughts. Dana can maybe ping in the chat. If you are in the middle of the sprint, how will you respond?
Yeah, first thing is I will see like what is the severity of it. Like if it is very much severity, then I would always check with my capacity of the team to see if any of those can be accounted. If not, what I will do is I will just put it in the product backlog item and I'll make sure I'll pull back in the next sprint items.
But practically, who has given us the authority to put it back in the product backlog item? Do you think in an IT vendor client engagement model, it is going to really work out?
I see. Ideally, this is the way to be followed. But giving the scenario like a number of vendors, then to not be the.
That is why people are actually struggling working on a weekend also for the release. Now you understood, no? From where the problems come. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just deliberately holding my thought because I wanted to see what Dana is typing. Dana, can you just enter it first in the meantime? So that I can read what you type. Priority will refer burn down chart whether an item can be picked. Okay, it's fine. So these are all your thoughts, whatever you are trying to tell until Dana is trying to tell. Now let me share my own thought. My thought is, do an impact analysis. See, okay, immediately to address the problem, if it is so burning issue, what you can do is, if there are some stories which is not being started by your team, like say, out of 15 stories, you have some 3 or 4 stories which is not been picked up by the team, remove the stories which is not started. Okay, descope the stories and then you add these new stories which is given by the product owner. It is simple. I cannot pour 10 liters of water within a 6-liter water bottle. It is anyway going to overflow. But all that I can do, if someone tells I need this water only to be poured, I can remove some water from the existing water bottle and I can give some space for the new water. Same story. You can descope something which is of a lesser priority, giving placeholders to insert or entertain the new stories, which is one. The other way is, create a requirements governance management within a sprint. For example, when you say impact analysis, based on what? Based on the timing, then based on the size of the work, the frequency of the change, the timing of the change, and also sometimes practically I will tell you, when that situation comes, I will also have a look into my agile contracting model or the SOW written, because my SOW clause will say, hey, if in the middle of the sprint, if there is a change beyond 15 points, maybe I may need to charge more to the customer. Right? Or what do you think?
Yeah.
So, a holistic answer, see, everyone will tell, the point is this, everyone knows to tell Like it depends. You need to tell depends on what, boss. That clarity should be there. We all know that it depends. Depends on what? Number one, the size of the change. Number two, the frequency of the change. Whether it is in one-time change or the product owner has got into the habit of giving off-baked requirements. The third thing could be like the during at what time the change comes. For example, if you are almost in the end of the sprint, and if someone is trying to come with a change, probably you can put that story as the first story in the next sprint.
Correct.
So I need to know the timing of the change. I also need to know what is the my contracting model or the SOW clauses say, and then only I can take a holistic call.
Okay.
Because every time removing some story and inserting a new story is perfectly fine, but why that behavior exists? Is it due to product owner's fault, or is it due to product owner himself is getting pressurized requirements from the top, from chief product owner or the product management team? From there, you may need to handle the problem. Now, let me tell you one more practical answer. Generally, the people who do certifications, trainers will not agree to this answer. But this is how the industry operates. See, you have your vendor organization, which I'm putting it as a V. You have your client organization, which I'm putting it as a CO. This is your vendor organization. You need to have appropriate change agents. Means, at this level of guy, you need to have someone from... So, see, to talk to this guy, you need to have someone from the vendor side. Similarly, to talk to a vice president or a VP from the client side, I need to have an appropriate leadership guy from the vendor side. Practically, you cannot expect this guy to influence this guy. You are getting it, no?
Yeah.
See, if you go to certification, people will literally blow me out. Like they will tell, no. Agile is all are equal. If all are equal, then why do you have Scrum Master? Then why do you have Enterprise Agile Coach? There is some difference that we need to respect it and then work. See, instead of saying that I don't have limitations, let us accept the limitation, respect it, and then work on the ways to overcome it. So what I used to do is when I'm getting into an agile transformation engagement, I will understand where am I from the vendor side and who are all there in the client side. You need to, you should not manage these stakeholders. You need to engage them. Okay, that's why in the PMBOK version 6, they have replaced the word management as a engagement. You need to know how do you engage your stakeholders. So you need to know all these things. Okay, through whom we need to communicate this. Instead of communicating with this guy, probably I need to route this communication internally here, and this guy need to take it up here. Then the flow of communication will actually come over here. This is a practical answer. I will tell an example. One of my Scrum Master told that he need to make some changes in the work item type, some process policies. And I also told him, okay, then you go and then do it. Then immediately a mail came from my client team saying that any changes to the individual squads will not be entertained. You need to make the changes at a program level with proper approvals. From the program team, all the changes will be cascaded down to the individual squads. So understand the landscape first. Understand your client ecosystem. Don't just blindly go by what a Scrum guide says or what your CSM or PSM material says. Because real life is different, certification is different. Understand the client landscape, understand the power equation there, then accordingly play the game in a diplomatic manner also. Getting it, what I'm trying to tell?
Yeah.
Because those are all the pain points what I had. I had one communication with my client manager saying that you are telling that this particular defect should not be exposed to the production, should not be exposed to client. But then Agile says we are promoting transparency, right? Then I should, for that my client manager told, boss, if you expose this, your vendor need to know penalty will be there. So do you want your company to pay the penalty? So there will be some situations, it is a trade-off call between being correct versus being appropriate. So be more appropriate rather than being correct alone. That's what I'm trying to tell. Yeah. All right. So we can take a pause here.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Okay. Fine then. Like I will also try to connect with Dana later. Anyway, he is in the call. Anyway, the recording will be there, and then we can give one day gap. In the meantime, I will send you some templates for today's class. Maybe you guys can go through it, and Tuesday we can take it forward. I will actually connect in the WhatsApp.
Okay, fine. Yeah, that should be fine.
First, stop the recording before I end the call.